So, the last two episodes of Netflix's Avatar live action were quite disappointing, at least the first time I watched it. My impression was that compared to the previous episodes, these two in particular were in fact the weakest parts of the whole season. Cause although the prior episodes to this one had the underdeveloped spirit world and the very horrible portrayal of not Roku, there were very good enough changes in those episodes, like the flashbacks especially of Zuko, Iroh, and Katara, that were really elevated and were great enough to save those episodes. But, however, I can't say the same for these last two episodes in the Northern Water Tribe. From too much dialogue to very, very odd scene portrayals, why does Yue talk like that? A kiss? Katara is a master. What? And other things I noticed. And does Aang even learn waterbending? And so, in this day, fellow mind, as we explore my thoughts on the last two episodes of Netflix's Avatar live action, be comfortable in any what way and welcome yourself here in mine mind. First of all, these episodes had a lot of noticeable issues, in particular with how dialogue was written and portrayed. As we will see in a bit, the dialogue is too on the nose and just presents as being overly descriptively detailed sometimes, and even worse, too casual in tone and cadence. We first see this issue at the opening as the gang spots Agna Kella. I initially really liked how they were talking about Aang's relation to Zuko in the prior episodes, but then the latter half of this discussion, somewhat just on topic and tone, changed from talking about how Zuko may not be as they think he is, and the connection Aang was feeling, to Aang just suddenly mentioning how he hasn't learned any of the other bending, and the gang's friendship.
I haven't learned any of the other bending skills, and I'll probably continue my-
Then how they spot Agna Kella was a bit underwhelming. It would have probably been better to make Katara question initially what they were looking at least for a moment, and then marvel at the realization. This would have given more flavor to the characters and their actions to let the viewer see their reaction, especially knowing that they came from a relatively meager background in the Southern Tribe. Instead of this bland and overly direct description of just spotting the Northern Tribe, like, wouldn't they not have an idea of what the North looked like? So how did they recognize it so suddenly? Then we have this guy, just randomly greeting them out of nowhere. That was just so misplaced. But then more of this very bland dialogue comes when the chief greets the gang. Firstly, he introduces everyone so directly and with very bluntly casual tone and cadence, which really diminishes the effect of the scene and makes the entire scenario feel cheap and not at all the grand arrival an audience would like to feel. It just feels so underwhelmingly delivered. This is supposed to be a big deal, but it doesn't feel like it. You know what? Let's compare these scenes from the original to the adaptation.
I'm Arnook, chief of the Northern Water Tribe, and I offer you our hospitalities and our protection in the name of the ocean and moon spirits.
Thank you. You don't know how long we've been looking forward to this.
I can't tell you the joy it brings us to welcome a long-lost brother and sister from the south. This is Master Paku. He is our senior waterbending master. And this is my daughter, Princess Yue, our tribe's spiritual leader.
Tonight, we celebrate the arrival of our brother and sister from the southern tribe. And they have brought with them someone very special. Someone who many of us believed disappeared from the world until now. The Avatar. We also celebrate my daughter's 16th birthday. Princess Yue is now of marrying age.
Thank you, Father. May the great ocean and moon spirits watch over us during these troubled times.
Now, Master Paku and his students will perform.
The cadence in which the lines are delivered and the subtle writing and actions of the characters in the original really make the scene feel important, as it should, as these are the final episodes and the culmination of their journey in Book One. But unfortunately for the live-action adaptation, we will see more of this odd delivery, and honestly, even the writing itself, I suspect the chances are the writers and directors are the ones at fault here. But aside from the very bland and very on-the-nose dialogue, the flow of the dialogue itself is very off. It doesn't feel smoothly flowing as like to transition properly into the next topic or scene. Just like in the beginning with the gang approaching the north, they just suddenly say things sometimes, or the lines themselves seem too blunt and too casual. We see this especially when Katara just suddenly learned of the North's culture against women waterbenders. In the original show, it was more impactful. The music, delivery of the lines, and even the writing of how she finds this out produces a dramatic and soul-crushing scene. While the adaptation has these sudden conversations that very clearly just want to direct the character to these plot points, almost more like a presentation rather than a real journey of events. But I do somewhat appreciate the omission of the necklace being Paku's, because the way Paku was convinced by that cool deal of the necklace was very, very oddly convenient in the original show. But I do say the reason why most people don't bat an eye at that is because the whole flow of the original show and story was so smooth that you can suspend your disbelief sometimes. Also, the original conveyed more and was more impactful while saying less than this adaptation, especially in revealing the North's sexism.
I'm sorry, I think there's been a misunderstanding. You didn't tell me your friend was a girl. In our tribe, it is forbidden for women to learn waterbending.
But yes, again, the adaptation lacks gravity in so many of its dialogue, though I do have to give credit to the banquet scene where Paku discusses the nature of waterbending. For me, it was quite the compelling scene. I like how he related the philosophy of their bending to Katara's situation. Now that's good dialogue right there. I hope they could have done that to the other dialogue, but frankly, it gets worse. Speaking of worse, Princess Yue's dialogue with both Aang and Sokka is every criticism I said so far and made more obvious. The kitchen scene with Sokka really diminishes her character, as it portrays her as not being overly, really serious as a character. Again, very overtly casual, that it lessens the integrity of the character and the impact of the character, and the feel, thus, of the story. But at least Sokka's still funny, I guess. We see this again with her interactions with Aang as she overly describes Avatar Kuruk to Aang. No subtlety at all, just very casually describing Kuruk and her thoughts about Kuruk like it's a presentation, just casual conversation. But then we get to see Aang's conversation with Avatar Uruk, which was a breath of fresh air from the boorish dialogue that came before. The intensity in his voice, quite nice. I wish they cast and directed the same quality with Roku.
Forgive
but
me.
Oh well, I do like how Uruk says that the vision will occur, but the outcome is not yet certain, not yet decided. A very nice concept that there are some things that you can't control and some things you can, which oddly enough ties into the philosophy of adaptability of waterbending. Okay, the romance is so backwards between Sokka and Yue. They barely even properly flirt and bond, and then they kiss while Aang's meditating in front of them. And then, and only then, they decide to properly bond and hang out. That's just the opposite of what should have happened. Like, it's, like, twisted all around. What? But enough about the water tribe. I do say the firebenders were better portrayed here, though some lines with Zhao were a bit redundant, like when he was explaining the invitation from Fire Lord Ozai to lead an armada to take the north. The interactions were fire, pun intended. Really amazing acting from the royal family, especially Iroh showing his depression face again and the subtle expressions from Ozai as he tries to push Azula was amazing indeed, which then resulted briefly in her blue flames and lightning. As we know, firebending is fueled not only by breathing, but by emotional drive. So that was a very nice touch. But yes, we see this sprinkled throughout the last two episodes. Now, given what we've noticed, let's discuss several important scenes, starting with a little weird character inconsistency. In the seventh episode, Aang rejects leading an assault, since he claims to be more of a defensive bender in his battle philosophy. But the very next episode, he just goes with the assault anyway. Also, throughout, we never see Katara or Aang learn waterbending at all, so how is Katara supposed to be a master already recognized by Paku and other waterbenders of the North? One of the key notes in the original show is that the scrolls was just a beginner's guide to waterbending, and that experienced masters were truly what would guide Katara to achieve her potential. Nothing can be a good substitute for a real master. That was what was said in the original show. I guess she just magically becomes a master. Ooh. All those poorly and overly descriptive and poorly written dialogue could have been cut or at least shortened to instead give Katara and Aang actual training scenes. Okay, but let's go on with the main event, I guess. The plot to slay the Moon Spirit apparently needs a knife? Why? I thought they took mortal form, thus being already at risk, as Yue said in the very same adaptation, to dying. Why the special knife? And again, Yue, stop explaining too much. Can the writers please be more subtle? Then, when Zhao finally threatens the fish, again compared to the original, the emotional tone of this scene, the gravitas was still inferior, though this adaptation did portray it decent. Now, I do like that Iroh, seeing as he was near the fish, actually tries and prevents Zhao from killing it. But after that one fire blast, doesn't even think to do anything else and just lets Zhao stab it? I thought you were going to unleash it tenfold on Zhao. What happened, Iroh? Just one fold, I guess. One punch of fire. Though the scene after the moon is slayed was very intense and really captured the sadness of the loss of the moon in battle. I really do say, credit where credit is due, that scene was very compelling. Really compelling battle, and Katara and Zuko was fine. The original had more nuance in it with the rising with the moon and sun lines, but Zhao versus Zuko was also very good here. The realization that Zuko was just being used by his father was so heartfelt. And is it just me, or was Katara's cries to Aang as he transformed with the ocean spirit too much, just a bit too much? Like, I felt that she could have just, like, be silent. It's just so unnecessary for me, a bit too much for me, really. And speaking of Aang's transformation, I don't quite like how it happened. The voice was very off and extra dialogue just made it cheaper. Like, compare it to the gravity, cadence, and tone of the original.
No,
Yue's sacrifice was good but utterly undermined by how she was portrayed. The one thing I do like is the detail that the ocean spirit isn't really bending the water, because that's what the moon does. It allows the ability to bend water. The ocean is simply the holder of the element. But let's then discuss the aftermath of and the ending scenes. We see Katara being acknowledged as a master, even though that doesn't really make any sense. But a peculiar detail is that by giving her the oasis water, Master Paku actually also invites them back, which might imply that they will return to the Northern Tribe in another season, perhaps to recruit them to fight in the Day of Black Sun. But then we see Azula indeed delivers her proposition to Ozai to let her go out into the war by successfully capturing Omashu. And the hinting of the return of the comet was indeed quite intriguing. Anyway, so all in all, I found these last two episodes not as good as the previous ones, as the season as a whole. The delivery and the writing, especially in the Northern Tribe, was very, very questionable. However, the Fire Nation really was best cast and portrayed throughout the season as a whole. But yes, Aang still hasn't learned any other water bending, any bending at all, even though this book is called Water. I guess Katara will just magic that up next season, the same way she just magically became a master waterbender.
That's right. You're gonna learn waterbending, and I'm gonna make sure of that.
But those were my thoughts on the last two episodes of Netflix's Avatar Book 1. Fellow mind, what are your own thoughts? Share them freely below. May we meet again soon. You are always welcome here, in my mind.